So synthetic biology, I'm just learning about this. It's, as I understand, the combination of tech with what you're doing in research. Explain to us what this is and its potential.
Well, that's right, David, and it's delightful to be back with you today. The potential is to have a totally new approach, a more efficient and effective approach to designing therapies and also to preventing disease. Synthetic biology itself is not that new. It began decades ago with recombinant DNA and being able to make human protein in microorganisms. And that, of course, led to the biotech revolution. Now, when you energize and supercharge synthetic biology with AI, we're able to accelerate that process of discovery and the development of new and more effective therapeutics.
So as I understand, this is a large language model, as they talk about it. How big a difference does that make in what you've been doing already? As you say, you've been doing this for some time.
It's a big difference in that it allows us to sort through multiple hundreds, thousands of possibilities in a much more efficient and effective way. So rather than having to run independent experiments for every different scenario, we're now able to make accurate predictions and hone in on the approaches that are most likely to be effective.
Do we know whether it works? I mean, do we have any treatments that have come out of this already to say we couldn't have had that, at least had it as soon as we did, but for AI?
We're already seeing the benefit in terms of the design of clinical trials and the interpretation of data from clinical trials. And with approaches like AlphaFold, which can predict the structure of any protein from its sequence, we've already sped up the process of developing some new therapeutics. Yes, we're already seeing the benefit, but I think we're still at the very early days.
What about the data? One of the things we've heard in other contexts about large language models is you need access to a vast amount of data. Do you have access to the data you need to achieve what you want to?
I think in some areas, like the data for proteins, yes. The data for nucleic acids, particularly RNA, which is a more variable molecule, we do need more, and we're constantly getting more data. When it comes to the data on humans' responses, on the health of humans, then we have to be very careful about that data to make sure that we're protecting the privacy of patients. That always has to be our first job.
So how are you going about that? That is a sensitive subject. And we know the president has an executive order out about AI more broadly, not just for healthcare. Are they heading in the right direction, do you think, with that executive order?
I think the executive order is headed in the right direction in that it prioritizes the protection of privacy, also prioritizes transparency about the algorithms to make sure that algorithms do not perseverate bias. I think all of us are deeply concerned about privacy. One approach is that rather than letting our data out of our healthcare system, which we do not do, we bring the models in so that the model comes in, but the data stays with the model in the system, not going out of the system.
As an academic, the leader of a major institution here, do you have a seat at that table, or is it being driven by some of the really big AI players?
We have a seat at the table. I think that there are some dominant AI players, but they have been very willing and indeed eager to see their models used, but used without having to own or even acquire the data that they're being used to interpret.
What about the competition we always talk about between the United States and China? You may not think about that in terms of medical research, but in general, we talk about that. Does China have an advantage because they have access to so much data? They just have so many people and they have all that data, and I don't think they worry about getting access to it.
I think data is important, but what is even more important is human capital. That is the expertise, the know-how, to be able to continue to evolve these models, to apply them in a responsible way. And that's where I think we in the United States have an advantage and should continue to focus on developing, nurturing that talent through our institutions of higher education and through industry.
So let's talk about what could be, and this is speculating a bit, but if this all works the way you hope it works, what does it do, for example, for cancer?
We've already seen in the past decade more advances in the diagnosis and treatment of cancer than in the previous two or three decades. And I think we're just at the early stages, just at the beginning. The ability to engineer our immune system, to use our own immune cells to attack and combat cancer, we're seeing that today, but that's going to accelerate. We're opening up the whole new frontier of cancer vaccines to engineer our immune cells, our individual immune cells, based upon the antigenic profile of a tumor cell. that's a whole new ball game for us, and I think one that will be very effective. Now, will it be a year, 3 years, 5 years from now? You know, in general, we tend to overestimate what we can accomplish in a short period of time and underestimate what we can accomplish in a longer period of time. We're all in this for the long game, and I'm optimistic about the future.
Well, how optimistic are you? I mean, as you look at it, I mean, and how much more optimistic than before AI as a practical matter? Do you think this is really more likely than not, or even much more likely than not, that at some point, as I understand, we don't know if it's 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, but at some point, we really will have at least part of an answer to cancer?
Yes, I think we will have, and you're keywords were at least part of an answer. This is going to come incrementally. It's not going to be as if one day we wake up and we have a new therapy that prevents or combats, cures all cancers. I don't think that's going to happen. But we're already seeing efficacy in ways that a decade ago we wouldn't have dreamed was possible. So we're at the early stages, and incrementally we're going to make progress that transforms our treatment of cancer.
What is holding us back, if anything? I mean, is it money? Is it people? Is it a regulatory system? What would you, if you got to change anything to speed it up, what would you do?
Well, you know, the United States traditionally has been the deepest and most reliable investor in biomedical research. We have to make sure that continues, because it's in our research institutions that the ideas germinate. It's where we train the people who generate those ideas, either in academia or in industry. We have to make sure, as a country, to remain competitive, we sustain that support and increase it moving forward.
So this has all been very positive, very encouraging. I don't want to take anything away from it, but what about risks? Particularly, we read from some people there could be sort of, I'll call it a superbug, that this possibility in the wrong hands could generate sort of pathogens that could really do damage to other countries or even the world. Is there a risk of that, and how do we protect against it?
Yes, there certainly is. And in our synthetic biology initiative at Stanford, there's a strong component focused on biosecurity. We know how, for example, to monitor the ingredients that go into making a nuclear weapon. Unfortunately, that turns out to be difficult. However, it's not nearly as difficult to engineer an organism or to engineer a virus. We need to be aware of those difficulties. We need to have accurate monitoring and surveillance systems. And we need to talk about the risks and make sure that everyone has an understanding of what those risks are and what to look for.
Where do those protections come from? Is it from the federal government? Does it need to be multilateral agreements, by the way? This is a global potential. Or should it come from academia? Where should it come from?
I think there needs to be thought leadership from all the sources you mentioned, certainly from the federal government, certainly from academia. We need to build a common base of understanding of what's possible, the probability of that happening, and then what we can do to either deter it from happening or detect it early if it is going to happen.